Hello everyone. Today I'm starting a new session of Preaching Python. Welcome to my first session. So today I'll be introducing you to Python, and this has been created in partnership with Not So Boring Lectures, and you should believe me. So to begin with, I would like to introduce you to Python. Python is an easy to learn, powerful programming language. Python lets you work more quickly and integrate your systems more effectively. In this session, we'll be covering three broad concepts. The first, to begin with, we'll be going through OOPs. Then we'll be introducing you to POP. And finally, it will come down to Python. So before anything else, let me ask you one simple question. How many languages do you need to know to be a good programmer? Yes, keep on guessing. But the answer is just one. The one that you excel in. Also, you may need a little help from your smartness. So here it comes to the first domain, that's OOPs. OOPs, as we all know, stands for Object-Oriented Programming. Is a programming paradigm, or maybe you can say as a style, which is associated with some concepts like class, objects, inheritance, encapsulation, abstraction, polymorphism. In object-oriented programming, computer programs are designed in such a way where everything is an object, and these objects that are the ones that interact with each other. The main aim of object-oriented programming is to bind together the data and functions into a single unit so that we can operate on them. And as a result, no other part of the code can access the data except the function where it has been defined. Most popular programming languages like Java, C++, Ruby, etc. follows an object-oriented programming paradigm. Next, to begin with, let me introduce you to three important components. One is an object, a class, and a method. So what is an object? As the name suggests, it's a basic unit, or maybe you can say a simple component of an object-oriented programming, and it represents the real-life entities. Let me give you an example. So here you can see a pen. It's simple. An object is as simple as a pen. It is an object. An object has three characteristics. One is a state, which represents the data, that is the value of an object. It has a behavior, which represents the behavior or functionability of an object. And then it has an identity that is maybe a unique ID or maybe a name. So an object can be any simple thing like a chair, as in real life. I'll be going into the broader explanation of objects as we proceed into programs. The next is a class. A class is a user-defined blueprint or a prototype from which objects are created. It represents the set of properties or methods that are common to all the objects of one type. Or maybe you can say a collection of the objects and the variables and the data that we define together, put together into a class. So an example, a class may be the entire animal category in real life. So just as a dog or a cat falls under the same class, similarly a lion or a tiger also falls under the same class. But this all dog, cat, lion, tiger, all these are unique and have their own characteristics. But all of them, when are compiled together, in the broader sense, we can say them as animal. So the class is simply just like an animal. The class animal. And finally, we have the method. A method or a function can be defined as a block of statement that performs some specific task and may or may not return results to the caller. What method allows us is to reuse the same segment of code into the program multiple times without writing them again and again. So next, we would like you to say hi to the core concepts of OOPs or object-oriented programming. They are polymorphism, inheritance, encapsulation, and abstraction. Yes, they are quite heavy terms, but let me dig into each one of them. So first, let's meet polymorphism. As the word suggests, polymorphism, the word has two sections, poly and morphism. Poly means many and morphism means forms. So in simple words, we can define polymorphism as the ability of a message to be displayed in more than one form, or to define a function or anything in multiple forms. A real life example of a polymorphism is a person at the same time can have different characteristics. Like a woman at the same time is a mother, is her wife, a sister, or even an employee. So see, a woman has various forms. That's the concept of polymorphism. Polymorphism allows us to perform a single action in a different way. That is, it allows us to define one interface having multiple implementations. The next on the list to meet is inheritance. Inheritance is an important pillar of object-oriented programming. It is the mechanism by which one class is allowed to inherit the features of another class. Let's say a real-life example, that is, a person inherits characteristics of their father or of their grandfather as well. Inheritance supports the concept of reusability. That is, when we want to create a new class and there is already a class that includes some of the code that we want, we can simply derive from our new class to our new class from the existing class that we have in hand. Next, let's meet encapsulation. Encapsulation is defined as the wrapping of data under a single unit. It is that mechanism which binds together code and the data that it manipulates. An example would be a medicine capsule. Just like the outer cover of the capsule binds together all the including droplets of medicines that we find in a capsule. Another way to think about encapsulation is, it is a protective shield that prevents the data from being accessed by the code outside the shield. Finally, we come to meet abstraction. Data abstraction is the property by virtue of which only the essential details are displayed to the user. The trivial or the non-essential units are not displayed to the users. A real life of abstraction can be, a car is viewed as a car rather than its individual components like the steering or the seats or even the engines. We don't consider it as that individual component, we consider it as a whole, as a car. Data abstraction may also be defined as the process of identifying only the required characteristics of an object, ignoring the irrelevant details. Next, we come to procedural oriented programming, or POP. This approach is known as the top-down approach. Here, data is global and all the functions can access global data. In this approach, a program is divided into functions that perform specific tasks. This approach is mainly used for medium-sized application. Here, the data is global and all the functions can access the global data, as I said. So, till now, I have introduced you to object-oriented programming as well as this procedural-oriented programming. As a matter of fact, Python supports both object-oriented and procedural programming-oriented, as it is a high-level programming language that is designed for general-purpose programming. So, till now, the concepts that I've imparted to you is basically to introduce you to Python. If you do much work on computers, eventually you find that there is some task that you would like to automate. If you're a professional software developer, You may also have to work with several C, C++, or Java libraries, but you may find the usual write, compile, test, recompile cycle is too slow. Python is just the language for you. To begin with, Python is a popular programming language, as I said. It was created by Guido van Rossum and was initially released in 1991. The most recent version of Python is Python 3.8. It was basically designed for readability. That is, it has some similarities with our day-to-day English language with influence from mathematics. Python is simple to use, but is a real-life programming language, offering much more structure and support for large programs than shell scripts or batch files can offer. On the other hand, Python also offers much more error checking than C. And being a very high-level language, it has high-level data types built in, such as flexible arrays and dictionaries. Python is an interpreted language, which can save you considerable time during program development because no compilation and linking is necessary. The interpreter can be used interactively, which makes it easy to experiment with features of the language, to write throwaway programs, or to test function during bottom-up programming development. The Python interpreter is usually installed Azure /user/local/bin/version of your Python on those machines where it is available. Let's see what Python can do. Python can be used on a server to create web applications. Python can be used alongside softwares to create workflows. Python can connect to database systems. It can also read and modify files. Python can be used to handle big data and perform complex mathematics. Python can be used for rapid prototyping or for production-ready software development. Along with numerous broad domains that Python can cover. Finally, the question is why Python? Why should you use Python? Python works on different platforms. It may be Windows, Mac, Linux, Raspberry Pi, etc. Python has a simple syntax similar to the English language, as I've already said. Python has syntax that allows developers to write programs with fewer lines than some other programming language. Python runs on an interpreter system, meaning that code can be executed as soon as it is written. This means that prototyping can be very quick. Python can be treated in a procedural way, as also as an object-oriented way, or maybe a functional way. These are some of the basic features that lets a programmer decide on Python over any other language. In this session, I have discussed the theoretical components of Python just to give you all a hint of the concepts that are essential for understanding Python. From the next session onwards, we will be digging into the coding part of Python. Thank you. Have a great day ahead.